Congratulations to the Department of Health Policy and Management. It's my pleasure to welcome you to this afternoon's session, part of our continuing series on health policy experts talking about key topics about health reform during this changing time. Today, it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Jeff Levi. His topic of his talk, as you can see on the slide in front of us, will be public and population health in an evolving health system. Let me give you a little background to Professor Levi before I start. Jeff just recently returned to George Washington University after a 10-year stint as the executive director of the Trust for America's Health, a leading public health advocacy and analysis organization. Actually, during that whole time, he was still with GW. In fact, he began with George Washington University about 20 years ago. This is probably your 20-year anniversary now. Started in 1997. But he has had a, in addition to being a wonderful teacher, much beloved here, he has had a luminous background. He was chairing, I don't know if you still are chairing, the White House Advisory Group on Prevention, Health Promotion, and Integrated Public Health. I suspect that advisory group might be defunct by now. but at an earlier time in the Clinton administration, he was deputy director of the White House Office of AIDS. He is also a GW alum, got his PhD from GW, no, though not from the public health school. So I like to think of Jeff as one of our leading strategists, chief strategists with respect to public advancing public health. I regret to say this was at a time when being chief strategist was sort of a good concept as opposed to a somewhat sinister concept. He's not a sinister person at all, though in the right light, maybe. But anyway, so this is today's talk. About a month ago, Sarah Rosenbaum gave a wonderful talk on some of the basic issues regarding health reform, and particularly some of the basic conceptual and legal issues that are going on. That is, if you are interested and available on YouTube, you can go to look for GWSPH and then click on videos under that heading, and then you'll see that Sarah's talk is still there. And in fact, this talk will also be recorded as well. And about a month from now, in March, I'll be giving a talk about the future of Medicaid and the health safety net. In early April, the School of Public Health will be convening a symposium on this topic. This is all evolving because, of course, we don't exactly know what's happening in Congress yet, as we'll all follow and learn as we go along. But with that being said, Jeff Levi.
Thank you, Professor Kuh. It's always unclear from moment to moment what we are strategizing about, but this is, not having checked my Twitter feed in at least 5 minutes, this is the current state of the action with regard to public health and a very volatile environment, to say the least. I would observe that despite predictions, say on November 9th, that by now we would have seen the repeal of the Affordable Care Act with or without a replacement, that train seems to be moving at a much slower pace. For those of us who watch public health, and the core of public health is so much dependent on annual appropriations, there is a tremendous vulnerability in the appropriations process that could see some very quick action, much quicker probably than with the ACA. And as insurance is taken away, people are aware of what is being lost. As public health funding is diminished, it takes time to realize what is missing until the next crisis. So with that really depressing overview, I want to step back a little bit and observe and give you a sense of what I'm going to try to cover, and I want to leave as much time as possible for discussion and questions. But really, this is a very much a glass half full conversation. As we see greater attention being paid to population health approaches, or what I will, as you will discover, call accountable health approaches, in the healthcare delivery system that really begins to move our health system from truly from just being a healthcare system to a health promoting system. That this, while incentivized and driven to some degree by the Affordable Care Act, is also happening independent of the Affordable Care Act because of the move toward more accountability, toward value-based purchasing. And if we are going to succeed in this very bipartisan concept of value-based purchasing, it's going to be important to have both partnerships with public health and have a very broad conception of what creates health, including addressing social determinants of health. That said, most of my talk is going to be about what surrounds the healthcare delivery system in creating healthy communities and a healthy population. But I cannot state strongly enough from a public health perspective that insurance matters. We sometimes forget that in public health because we're worrying about the general health of the population. But in fact, insurance matters because a lot of public health interventions are delivered one person at a time, and a lot of public health interventions do have a base in the clinic. Whether it is preventive benefits that were made much more robust and much more accessible by the Affordable Care Act, or whether it is there are incredibly important issues around what networks look like and what coverage really looks like, so that preventive services can be built. Those changes in the ACA have not just been profound for individuals, they have been profound for public health departments as well. Because public health departments, one of the essential functions of public health is assurance of access to appropriate preventive services. As the insurance system has taken on more of that responsibility, public health departments have been able to move away from direct clinical service delivery to thinking about policy systems and environmental change. With that shift is a shift in focus, a shift in capacity. If insurance goes away, that will become a real challenge for public health. So in fact, this is from a paper by Karen DeSalvo and John Auerbach, who describe the concept of public health 3.0. That in the early days, there are various ways that you can look at this. Public health 1.0 was very much focused on infectious disease control and the rudimentary approaches to public health. Public health 2.0 really began to think about more expansively about a role of public health, particularly around chronic disease prevention. And in public health 3.0, we're really talking about the collaborations and the partnerships that allow us to lead for public health, in Karen DeSalvo's term, being the chief health strategist for a community, for the nation, can start addressing and catalyzing improvement in the social determinants of health. All of these are built on the changes in the insurance and the healthcare delivery system. If those changes go away, then there's the danger of public health having to revert back to public health 2.0 or public health 1.0, depending on how far back we go, without having retained the capacity to do some of those services. So population health is certainly the new buzzword. Everyone says they do population health. Healthcare systems say they do population health. Public health says they do population health. And everyone sort of defines population health a little bit differently. David Kindig, who is probably the philosopher of population health, has defined it as the health outcomes of a group of individuals, including the distribution of such outcomes within the group. So it can be geographic, it can be population specific. But the bottom line is that this is thinking much more broadly than one person at a time. And that it is not just about the overall health of a population, but the distribution of health. In other words, issues of equity. Then the question really becomes, who delivers population health? And I would argue, and there's a lot of argument about who is doing true population health. When a healthcare system says they're delivering population health, they're probably thinking about their patients. When public health thinks about population health, they're thinking about everybody. And so, you know, public health thinks they're purer, and therefore, since they think about everyone, that makes them better. It actually doesn't matter, because to achieve population health outcomes, whether you define your population as, you know, the beneficiaries in a Medicaid program, or the patients who come to George Washington University Hospital, or a geographic community, or a minority community whose health you may be concerned about, it doesn't really matter, because to achieve population health in our current understanding of what really does improve outcomes, it requires partnerships. It requires working across sectors. It requires paying attention to equity issues. And it certainly requires paying attention to social determinants. Now, I put of health in brackets, because when we're working with other sectors, you know, education may be a social determinant of health to us, but in the education sector, health is a social determinant of education. And in fact, to create viable partnerships, we really need to be thinking about how we work across those sectors and define population health in a way that is meaningful to all of those sectors. So everyone can be doing population health, whether it's a hospital partnering with a community-based organization that provides community health workers to help them stay healthy and not get readmitted within 30 days because CMS, through their value-based purchasing, will ding them otherwise, or whether it's a health department sitting at a table with the education sector and housing sector and others to really address some of the upstream social determinants of health. A lot of the emphasis in the public health world around population health is focused on policy systems and environmental change. So that's our new mantra. And it's true. You can achieve a lot and have a tremendous impact on a lot of people if you make policy changes. But the truth of the matter is, as we think about social determinants of health, we also have to think about direct service delivery. So when you're thinking about addressing the health-related social needs of an individual, so we know that there needs to be an adequate supply of housing. That's a policy and systems change. But we still need the structures in place that link that individual who needs housing with the housing that may be available. So it is both. So this is probably a familiar slide to many of you. This is Elizabeth Bradley's work showing that, in fact, those countries that spend more on those social services, those things addressing what we would call the social determinants of health, tend to have better outcomes, and they are spending more on social services than on healthcare services. So you can see the United States sort of in the middle there. When you add healthcare spending and social services spending together, we are sort of, we're not that different from the rest of the world. It's just we spend a lot more on healthcare and a lot less on social services, and we have poorer outcomes. So a conclusion from this is that we have an imbalance here, and we might get a bigger return on investment if we spent more on social services. And I agree with that. But the care that we need to take in looking at slides like this or data like this is that it's not like we can flip that switch and suddenly reverse the ratio. We have a legacy of medical problems that have been created because we haven't addressed those social determinants. And we will not see those savings immediately if we ramp up our investments in social determinants. So it's in social services. So it's much more complicated than just flipping that bar graph. So I've mentioned a couple times actually thinking less about population health and thinking about accountable health. So we're in this world that thinks more and more about value-based purchasing and holding people accountable for outcomes. We all believe in that. And the concept of accountable health is, to some degree, a subset of population health, but it avoids some of the arguments around definitions. Accountable health approaches, and there are many approaches to accountable health, as I'll describe in a moment, integrate in varying degrees the health and prevention and public health, the healthcare and social needs of individuals and communities in order to improve health outcomes, reduce costs, and resolve upstream factors that affect health. So it takes the healthcare system, it takes public health and prevention, and it takes social determinants, and together says, how can we hold all of those players together accountable for improving the health of a community while staying true, I should add, to their core missions? So we can't be turning housing agencies into health agencies, but we need to find ways to have housing agencies understand, or organizations understand, that they are contributing to health, and to adapt their work so that they do most effectively advance health outcomes. So value-based purchasing is really driving this move toward accountable health. You know, as health systems and others become held accountable in a financial way for improved health outcome, for rewarding outcomes over volume, it becomes more and more important to mobilize the necessary forces, so to speak, or activities or programs or policies that address everything that can affect health and can result in a reduction in demand for care. So I would distinguish accountable health from accountable care by saying that accountable care holds providers responsible for better management of clinical conditions. And you do have to have a link with the community and with community-based services and addressing some social determinants of health to better manage those clinical conditions. Accountable health creates a shared responsibility across all sectors for the health of a community or a patient population. Now, these are relatively new concepts. There are lots of experiments happening on both the accountable care side and the accountable health side. Accountable care is not just for Medicare anymore. There are 10 states that now have Medicaid accountable care organizations, with 6 in the planning stages. And there are 13 states that have created what are being called accountable communities for health. Some people call them accountable communities for health, some people call them accountable health communities, but some form of an accountable health experiment. So this is very much an experiment. It's being tested. The financing mechanisms vary. We don't know which ones work best. The sustainability of these experiments is very much in question, but this is very much a direction that the creative people in trying to improve health outcomes tend to be moving. So the ACA has made a huge difference in moving us toward and creating the building blocks for this notion of accountable health or better addressing population health. The first is the creation of the National Prevention Council and their issuance of a national prevention strategy. And I have chaired, I don't know whether it's quite yet the past tense, the Advisory Group on Prevention, Health Promotion, and Integrative and Public Health. And I won't go into detail on this, though many of you have heard me speak at length on this, except to say that while obviously this is not the centerpiece of the ACA, it actually set the National Prevention Council set a table within the federal government where 14 federal agencies and offices were called together and said, prevention and health promotion is now part of your mission. And together they developed this national prevention strategy where they talked about creating healthy and safe community environments, which didn't just mean clean air and clean water, but understanding that if you didn't have safe streets, people couldn't be outside exercising. In talking about elimination of health disparities, it wasn't just what happened in the clinical setting, but also talked about the social determinants of health, and therefore how everyone has a role to play. And I could go on and on about that, but I think the bottom line here is it was a recognition on the part of the federal government and an integration into the work of each of these federal agencies with varying degrees of success, the notion that health is part of their work. Department of Housing and Urban Development was probably the strongest in that regard. They actually elevated health to their mission statement, but the Department of Defense has also done amazing work in integrating truly social determinants and community and policy and systems change in the communities that they control like bases, to really think much more broadly about what affects health outcomes. Oops, I need to go this way. Obviously, I mentioned earlier the importance of the coverage of clinical preventive services, how that has freed up health departments, how that has freed up resources, I think has been incredibly important. The investment in community prevention also cannot be underestimated. So we have moved from a concept of saying in public health to improve health promotion is brochures and health fairs and educating people about what it means to be healthy, to really thinking about the community environment, how we create a safer community for exercise, how we make healthier food more accessible, how we start looking at the policies like smoke-free air laws that can have a dramatic effect on broader populations. And over the course of the last 8 years, there's been a tremendous investment in creating that kind of prevention capacity at the local level that requires not a health department issuing regulations necessarily, but creating the coalitions and setting the table of the various sectors who need to come together to make these changes. So starting with the Recovery Act, with the Communities Putting Prevention to Work program, and then funded through ACA mechanisms, there's been close to $2 billion that has gone out to communities and states across the country to build that kind of prevention capacity of setting tables. Now, the truth of the matter is that Congress has a limit, well, this is going to come somewhat surprised. Congress has a limited attention span and can't stick to programs for any length of time. Communities Putting Prevention to Work was part of the Recovery Act, so that was a time-limited intervention. Community transformation grants were supposed to be 5 years. Congress decided after 3 years, well, we don't really like that approach as much as we thought, even though they had no outcomes yet because they hadn't given them a chance to have outcomes, and they switched to partnerships to improve community health. So a lot of pulling and starting and stopping, but what's consistent here is providing support to communities to set a broader table. The capacity and the experience of public health agencies as conveners of multi-sector collaborations has been really important in setting the table for a role in this accountable health movement. The Prevention and Public Health Fund has been an incredibly important part of the ACA for public health. It is the first mandatory funding stream that public health has had. So this is now $1 billion a year that comes available every October 1. It was meant to be used for new initiatives. It's actually been a balance of new initiatives and protecting some core functions of public health, like lab capacity, and actually some of the immunization programs during a time of budget cuts and sequester. But that fund has been, without that fund, the CDC budget would be 12% smaller, which means that state and local health departments would have 12% less to work with. So that's been incredibly important and has been constantly at risk. It has been repealed dozens of times, at least by the House. It never became law. And is probably is certainly one of the vulnerable targets in a repeal and replace environment. The community benefit rules for hospitals certainly could be a topic of an entire discussion. The requirement for nonprofit hospitals to invest in their communities, there are various elements to that. And our colleagues here in the department, Sarah Rosenbaum and Maureen Burns, have published about this. But for public health, what's important is the requirement for doing a community health needs assessment and to do that in collaboration with public health departments. And so in creative communities, there's been an opportunity not just for collaboration, but for leadership by public health agencies in bringing the nonprofit hospitals together to do a common community health needs assessment. And again, where there are creative communities and where there is creative leadership and a willingness to play this chief health strategist role in a community, hospitals, health departments have also been working with hospitals on how they implement their investments based on that needs assessment plan. The ACA has also made a difference in terms of the health workforce. The ACA supported primary care expansion, over 16,000 new providers. That was money, that the money for those programs actually came from the Prevention and Public Health Fund. Not the original purpose of the Prevention Fund, but an important investment nonetheless. And you can see a number of other examples from teaching health centers, but I think and interprofessional practice and education grants, but what I think is also important to take into account is that through these changes in the ACA, we are seeing a much more inclusive workforce that includes community health workers, community EMS, as part of health teams, and that means, and we have begun to see Medicaid reimbursement of non-licensed professionals, like community health workers, who are providing preventive services. That provides an opportunity to have a much broader sense of who does health and who contributes to health and to build community capacity. The innovation across, you know, the healthcare system and the healthcare financing system has also played a very important role in beginning to embrace population health. CMS has developed a population health framework that describes CMS's role in this regard. They have worked to, within the limits of what CMS can legally do, because remember, they have to think about what is the impact on beneficiaries as opposed to an entire geographic community. Within those legal constraints, they've really been much more flexible about thinking about public health partnerships, about thinking about community-level interventions. You know, some of the drivers of innovation include the Medicaid expansion, which means needing to address the needs of a different population. Many of the solutions to those needs can be found in the community. States have been using Medicaid waivers, as I mentioned earlier. 13 states have used their either the state innovation model grants or waivers to create something that looks like accountable health communities or accountable communities for health. I mentioned the use of non-licensed providers in prevention services. And in fact, Medicaid managed care is already addressing a lot of social determinants of health under the radar. So managed care plans have a lot of flexibility to think about addressing social health-related social needs. They've been doing it under the radar because they haven't quite sure whether CMS, if they looked under the hood, would say, ooh, that's really okay. But as CMS has embraced more of this population health framework and has become more flexible, we're learning about more and more managed care plans that have done innovative things with schools, have done innovative things around housing, have done innovative things around financial literacy, and on and on and on. Within the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation, obviously the state innovation model grants have promoted the accountable communities for health. The diabetes prevention program and its certification now as a Medicare benefit is a community-based service that has been shown to be more effective in preventing progression to diabetes than clinically-based approaches. And playing catch-up in a sense, CMMI has put out, and we are still waiting with fingers crossed for the awards to be made, for an accountable health communities demonstration, $157 million that would go across the country to look at various approaches to addressing health-related social needs, but at the core is this accountable health community model. And this would provide a real opportunity with a substantial investment to build the capacity in communities and really evaluate the impact of this approach on health outcomes and on costs. But overarching all of this is this increased drive toward value-based purchasing. That is not just ACA-driven, but it is market-driven, and it has very broad bipartisan support. With this growing evidence that if you address health-related social needs, you will improve outcome and value, and it's interesting to hear, as the governors start talking about what might happen to Medicaid, many of them are saying, we want to preserve or enhance our ability to address these health-related social needs. So even in an environment where governors may say we want more flexibility from the federal government, part of the flexibility they are looking for is the ability to address these health-related social needs. There are challenges in doing this, because as we know, both purchasers, whether it's private employers or the federal government or Medicaid agencies, all have relatively short time horizons and want to see a relatively rapid return on investment. Actually, they want to see not just a return on investment, they want to see actual savings. So you can get a quick fix, in a sense, by providing short-term housing. We know for very high-risk patients with high utilization of emergency departments, housing instability is probably the biggest driver of their high costs. And if we address that housing instability, we'll be able to reduce costs. But there is also a need to think about the long-term interventions that over a lifetime will dramatically reduce costs and improve outcomes. And yet we see some managed care plans doing that. One example is the good behavior game. There's the CCO in a community care organization in Oregon that is supporting the integration of the good behavior game in the schools. Good behavior game has been shown through NIDA research over a generation to dramatically reduce healthcare costs, reduce substance use, reduce interaction with the criminal justice system, improve employment, improve income, all of these social determinants of health. And what's wonderful about the good behavior game is you're not selling it to the education system as, here's something you could do to contribute to social determinants of health. The good behavior game is actually a classroom management tool. And so teachers will be able to better manage their classroom. And so as they are improving their approach to teaching, they're also addressing social determinants of health. That's one of many examples where those health plans who think not just about short-term cost savings, but also think about their community utility function, are willing to make those kinds of investments. All that said, different communities have different capacity to address these needs, and it takes money up front to create those tables, support those tables, and not inexpensive at all, the data systems that will allow these multiple sectors to work together. Now, that said, again, there are a lot of these experiments in working with my colleague in the back, Jan Heinrich, at our funders forum on accountable health. We have been documenting a huge variety of programs across the country that are doing this kind of work. So in a sense, CMMI is catching up with the field, but the CMMI investment will be critical to understanding what works. So that said, we are in a new environment. And the question is, what are those challenges and opportunities? And here's my attempt to see the glass half full. We'll see how I do. The Prevention and Public Health Fund is very much at risk. And as I mentioned, if there is not just a repeal, for example, of the Prevention Fund, but also, as some people expect, across-the-board cuts in the base budget of all non-discretionary domestic programs, then we could see a dramatic reduction in the capacity of public health to do their core functions, and therefore a dramatic reduction in their capacity to engage in this kind of community prevention, to play that leadership role, and to take on functions in a value-based purchasing system. So that is certainly a major challenge or threat. The threat to Medicaid expansion and the potential of Medicaid block grants could mean, certainly on the block grounds, and the Medicaid expansion, if people lose coverage, as I said earlier, that's a tremendous threat and for public health, for access to key public health-related benefits, but also will put pressure on public health departments to revert to old service delivery models. A block grant structure could mean greater flexibility, as I mentioned earlier, to address population health-based approaches, and indeed, the more constrained a Medicaid budget may be for a state, the more likely they will want to engage in value-based purchasing arrangements. But it also needs to be understood that even if in the long term, something like an accountable health approach may be more effective in achieving value-based purchasing goals, if those block grants are not adequately funded, it's not just that not enough people will be served, but the resources for innovation, the resources for developing the capacity to start an accountable health approach is going to be impossible because it takes an upfront investment to make these things work. And I also think we need to be honest that these approaches are not fully baked. And so whatever our new financing system is, we will need to continue to invest in research and innovation and study these innovations in a way that we know which of these approaches to accountable health is most effective, what kind of capacity is needed, and how we build the capacity of communities to play in this arena. While we might say that there are many, many communities across the country engaging in this kind of approach, the truth of the matter is that only a fraction of communities have the capacity to do this work. And it's going to take investment either on the public health side or on the healthcare side to make sure that we scale that capacity across the country to build those coalitions. So in short, it all depends. Will whatever emerges from the sausage making of the legislative process mean that we have similar levels of coverage? Coverage meaning both the number of people covered and what is covered. Will we have enough money in the system to sustain a strong, or at least less weak, public health system? And will the Medicaid and CHIP and other healthcare investments be robust enough to really support what it takes to have an accountable health vision for value-based purchasing? With that, I would love to open it up to questions. Stunned you into silence. Susan.
So, I heard a lot about all these experiments happening all over the country and how there's support coming from different sources, most of which are at risk. But part of my question is, does it still depend on your zip code and whether or not your state or your community has taken up one of these issues? Or how do we, in an optimistic world, how do we encourage that spread? And then add on the pessimistic vision of under these current circumstances.
So the geographic spread is not by predictable zip code. So some of these experiments are happening in states like Texas and Idaho, where perhaps you might not expect them to be happening. Some of them are also happening in California and New York and so on. So in that sense, I don't think your zip code is the driver. I think what we do have to be concerned about is that even within those states, there are only a handful of communities that have the ability or are getting the support to do this. Actually, the Idaho experiment is one that is happening on a statewide basis. That's actually relatively rare. It tends to happen in pockets. Some of them can be pockets of very high need. But just as the CDC's community prevention investments were not evenly spread across the country, with a lot of these are competitively awarded projects, and the people who, especially with something new, you want to go with the people who are most likely to succeed. Some of the work that we're doing at the Funders Forum is really about identifying that second tier of folks who have applied to, whether it's public funders or private funders, to do this kind of work and didn't make it, but have an interest, and what can we do to help build their capacity so the next time around they're able to leverage that. Professor Koo.
So I have a question that's always, I'm concerned in areas of public health. And that also links back to this issue of sort of what we're doing in a new environment with more flexibility and with sort of how it links to health insurance. And this is, how does one decide what's a good policy? Historically, there were certain things will cover certain things. So coverage is a defining limit in insurance of what we will pay for and what we won't. That you can step up and say, we want to have nudges. We want to have more things that are educational, more things that make it easier to do what we view as being the right thing. And then there's another stage that basically says, no, we want to be a little pushier about this. So we want to say, if you don't do something, we're going to take away part of your insurance, or we're going to do something so you're sanctioned if you don't stop smoking, if you don't eat the right foods. And so this may range in a variety of ways that public health people are divided about. You know, so, you know, should we charge higher insurance for people, premiums for people who smoke? Should we have taxes related to sugary drinks? And so where does one draw the line of what's reasonable, what's effective?
So I guess I would distinguish between policies at the community level and policies within the insurance system. So I would say from a public health perspective, we want people to have maximum access to insurance coverage, regardless of their health status, and as well, regardless of their health behaviors. Because if you believe what we in public health say, so the two areas that people would point to most, or three areas might be around substance use, around tobacco use, and around obesity prevention. Certainly around substance use and tobacco use, we can say those are medical addictions, and there's a medical approach to it, and there's also a community approach to it that can help prevent or mitigate it. But those are medical problems, even though we tend not to think of tobacco that way. We tend to be much more stigmatizing about tobacco use, though tobacco cigarettes are designed to make you an addict of it, make you addicted to nicotine. And on the obesity side, I would also argue that, you know, there are both genetic aspects and community level aspects to this, and that our focus should be on assuring people get access to the appropriate care, and we build a community environment that makes it easier for people to make the healthier choice. Where I thought you were going, I would go a step further, which is, you know, it's a lot easier for us in public health to come up with the list of, here are the covered preventive services benefits, though some of them may get disputed, but here are the list of covered preventive services benefits that everyone should have, and everyone should have without any cost sharing. When it comes to what are the community level interventions, whether it's dealing with a food desert, whether it's dealing with smoke-free air laws, whether it's dealing with housing problems, whatever, that's going to be a very community-driven decision, driven by what's already in place, the different, very much driven by zip code in terms of what is needed in a particular community. You could have two communities with equally bad health outcomes, but one may need to be addressing housing, another may need to address jobs. And both would be public health interventions, and both would be important. And what we are very bad at the federal policy level, is understanding that we need to create the capacity at the local level to do these things. And we may even give them a menu of things that work, but we can't say every community has to be doing X. That makes monitoring a grants program much harder. That makes evaluating a grants program much harder. But it's the reality of what is faced, which is why I think, to some degree, federal public health should get out of the business of doing prescribed interventions and more into the business of creating that capacity at the local level for public health to convene and to bring sectors together and to bring together then whatever funding streams are necessary to address what the community identifies. That's a letting go that is very hard to do. But we've done it in other arenas. We've certainly done it in HIV prevention. We've done it in HIV services. It can also be done in this arena as well. And that was the vision, to some degree, of those early community prevention programs. Dr. Dunham.
Great talk, as usual. So with this new administration and everybody's waiting anxiously to see what will happen on the healthcare side, where do you see the universities and the schools of public health stepping up to maybe reach out to the White House and to the new folks that we need to talk to so that they're aware and enlightened, so maybe they'll end up giving you your glass half full and half
Well, the policy analysis function that schools of public health do, and that we certainly do here at GW, is critical to the conversation. And whether it is administration officials or members of Congress or advocacy groups who then pick up that analysis, we can at least help frame the discussion and put those issues out there. What people ultimately do with them politically is a separate issue, and what students or faculty do, you know, in their own time around pushing those agendas forward is also a separate issue. But our job is to believe that facts still do matter, and that analysis still does matter, and that we make sure that the implications of different policy proposals actually are understood, so that when a vote happens, no one comes back a year later and said, well, I had no idea it was going to mean X. It could be a good thing or a bad thing. But that they really understand what, to the degree that we can potentially understand it, what is known. And I also think that we need to be careful in saying what we do know and what we don't know. So that's why I've been very careful about saying accountable health communities, very promising, really exciting, seems to be going well, seems to be fitting well with value-based purchasing. But we still need to know better how it works and what is the best way of doing it. Because if we oversell, then we won't, and something gets scaled and it doesn't work, we'll be much worse off. Professor Rosenbaum.
So it was a great talk. And my question goes to what I think is a fundamental point that you make here and you've made throughout on public health policy, which is that it's a concept that's owned by a lot more than public health agencies. So it's a very diffuse policy that permeates lots of different ways in which we all relate to one another and institutions relate to one another. I wonder sort of what is happening in public health agencies themselves to ready them to have this much bigger conversation and level of interaction with the world around them than they might have had. What some of the leadership activities might be, which I know you're involved with some, and how those might be affected by any of what's going on.
So a really good question. I think we need to start with the premise that there are about 2,700 public health agencies across the country, and let's just say they have varying capacity. They can be a part-time person, and they can be a huge health department, you know, that is larger than any state health departments like New York City. So the capacity varies tremendously, and the understanding of roles varies tremendously. That said, I think within the public health movement, this notion of public health as a chief health strategist rather than someone who delivers care, again, can mean many things to different people, but is really something that has taken hold. The accreditation movement has elevated the notion that there is a core capacity that every health department ought to be able to demonstrate, and being able to address policy and systems change is one of those. The work that Karen DeSalvo did before she left as acting Assistant Secretary for Health in starting this conversation around public health 3.0 is really meant to move the public health community to understand this broader role. All of that said, we have a long way to go, and if financing, you know, the danger in any financial cutback is that you shrink back to what you used to do, rather than say in a more constrained environment, let's focus on where still we want to be going. And I think that's a constant danger. And I think we also need to be honest, which people verbalize, but I don't know whether they internalize, that sometimes the chief health strategist will be the public health agency. Sometimes it will be another entity in the community because of their capacity because of their leadership skills, because of the resources they may have to invest. There are some communities where the community benefit program of a hospital functions almost as a parallel health department. And that's not necessarily a bad thing if they can pull that off. There are going to be some communities where a health system is sufficiently dominant, but also sufficiently committed to creating a healthier community, because the more dominant they are, the more they have a financial incentive to do this, where they will take on some of those chief health strategist roles. So we need to be willing to be flexible in that regard, depending on what the capacity of an existing health department is. Yeah?
If the ACA is repealed, to what extent would you expect that all of these initiatives, what happens to them? And not only, I guess, on the ground in terms of what all of those programs are going to look like, but in terms of all of these approaches that healthcare systems are taking and value-based purchasing, what do you expect that to look like?
So, as much as the House Freedom Caucus may wish, it is not just going to be repealed. It is also, there's also going to be something that replaces it. So that's the fundamental question. How much of this can survive in a replace or repair approach? And I think the answer, the safe answer to that is it all depends. I think the directly funded programs under that are supported by the Prevention Fund may well be at greatest risk in a repeal and replace environment. I think there is actually a bipartisan understanding that innovation is going to need to be important, and the degree to which both Republican governors and Democratic governors have been working with these kinds of accountable health experiments, I think give it legs to some degree. The question is whether those legs will have enough of a foundation to stand on to make what some of these governors want to do work. And I worry that, again, you worry about the immediate crisis in front of you, and the immediate crisis in front of you is, will I have enough dollars in the Medicaid system to be able to continue covering the people I am covering, including the expansion population? And a lot of Republican governors are very focused on that. Will they also say, are there going to be enough dollars to do this innovative, continue this innovative work? I don't know how high that is on their priority scale. So, the question was about the states that want to have a work requirement associated with Medicaid, and are there more positive approaches to this issue? And I think the short answer to that is yes. Hennepin County, in their experiment with this kind of work, they call it a social accountable care organization. And this is with, they did an early expansion. So this is focused on the expansion population. And they do job placement and job training. They tap resources from the county to link people to job training and job placement. It is not a condition of getting the Medicaid services. So if you set the table the right way and you feel you have a population that could be working and with some training and support could begin to work, you can bake that into an accountable health approach.
Have they documented health improvements or savings?
They have documented health improvements and savings overall. I don't think they break it out they're doing all sorts of interventions, so that's not the only one, so I don't know that they could say with that intervention they resulted in savings. There's a constellation of intervention. That's always going to be the challenge. When you're dealing with social needs, you're not going to be dealing with one social need at a time and saying, is that the one that made the difference? You're going to deal with a constellation of them, and together addressing that constellation will make a difference.
And it's worth noting that there are two recent studies that document sort of the inverse, which is that the Medicaid expansion promotes work. A study by John Ayani in Michigan, and now a study from the state of Ohio as part of its own evaluation of its own Medicaid expansion. So there's evidence that, in fact, one of the real gains from eliminating the need to show disability in order to get Medicaid as an adult is that people are able to go to work.
All right. Okay, thank you very much.